Hi, welcome to Management 301. Before I get into any details, let me tell you a story, one that very effectively illustrates what this course is about and what the main challenges in this course are. I normally tell this story with an activity that I do in the classroom, but because you're taking this course online, you can't really participate, so you have to settle for simply hearing and trusting me that this is how it goes. Anyway, when I teach this course in the classroom, in face-to-face settings, even before I introduce myself, I do this activity. I come to my class and I ask my students in the class which way is north. And normally I would have about 100 students in the classroom, and they're puzzled for a while, but then I say, no, I seriously mean which way is north. And then they start pointing in all kinds of directions. One thing happens all the time. We have roughly an equivalent number of fingers pointing in any given direction. So you would see just about anything there. And then I would say to my students, well, look around. You see that a good portion of this class disagrees with you. So I'm going to ask this question again, but only if you know the answer for sure. Only if you are absolutely certain you know the answer, then give me the answer. So, which way is north? At that point, about one-third of the class drops out, but then the other two-thirds are pointing still in all kinds of directions. Some people even point up. And then I say, well, you realize all these people in this classroom have roughly the same background as you do. So most of them are, 20-something? Most of them have some work experience. Most of them study, well, all of them study at the UNCG, come from more or less the same background. So you realize, statistically speaking, they are as likely to be right as you are. And so since you're pointing in different directions, somebody's got to be wrong, and you may be that wrong person. So let's do it again. Which way is north? Drop out if you're not sure. Participate only if you're absolutely certain you know the answer. At that point, I would still have about 15 to 20 students who still point in the different directions. I choose two that point in the completely opposite ways. I say, are you sure you know better than that student in the red shirt? Are you sure? And the student says, sure, I'm sure. And I say, the other guy, are you sure? And he says, absolutely. And then I say, listen carefully. And watch, because this is what Management 301 is about. And what is it about? Even when the evidence is overwhelming that most of you are wrong, somehow you still stick with your opinion and you blindly follow that opinion. And that's the problem in international business. I used to teach statistics, and in statistics, the biggest challenge I had as an instructor was to convince the students that statistics is not that difficult. It's comprehensible. You guys can learn it. In international business, the challenge is the opposite. I have to play this bad guy role, and my job frequently is to prove that you have no idea what you're talking about. That even though you know the word immigration or exchange rate or international trade, in most cases you have no idea what actually those things are. And when the exam time comes, many students find their grades to be unacceptably low because they thought they knew everything. Of course I know who immigrants are. Of course I know that there are different currencies and I know how to exchange them. Of course I know that trading with China is bad, for example, because they steal our jobs and stuff like that. Well, it turns out there is much more to it than most people know. Ask 10 people on the street, like 10 randomly people on the street, random people on the street, what needs to be done about immigration in the United States. I bet that out of 10, 9 will not only tell you what needs to be done, they will actually tell you that they know better than anybody else, and everybody else must listen to them because they know best. At the same time, take 10 people on the street and ask them something about, I don't know, accounting principles or statistics, and most of them will say, oh, I don't know, it's not my area. Well, the problem is that those people who claim that they know what needs to be done about international business, like all those, you know, NAFTA, international trade, immigration, dollar exchange rate, most people who claim that they know what needs to be done, not only most, in fact, probably all of them, but a few. So most of them have never actually read any specialized literature on the topic. Most of them, all they really know about that is, you know, something from their personal experience and whatever they hear in the presidential campaign ads. But believe me, that's not sufficient to fully understand the topic. So, by the way, at the end of this exercise with the compass, I do actually take out a real compass. I do point, you know, to north. And then, you know, most people say, oh, I didn't know. And then somebody usually, you know, wins and says, oh, I knew. But again, the point of this exercise is not really what the correct answer is. It's about opening up your mind and being open to things that you may disagree with, things that you always knew answers to and they turn out to be wrong, or at least you have to be ready that they may turn out to be wrong. So in this course, we will be talking about many sensitive issues, like, as I said, international trade, job outsourcing, democracy versus totalitarianism, free market versus command economy, immigration, regional integration, like, you know, NAFTA with Canada and Mexico. All those things are hugely emotional. Most of those issues we have preconceived opinions about. And so many things that I will say will be completely different from what you grew up to know up until now. And I just hope you will give me a chance to explain to you my point of view. And in most cases, it actually will not be necessarily my point of view. It will be what the data, empirical data, shows us and what the experts on the topic have to say. People actually work with this, not Glenn Beck on, you know, or Rush Limbaugh or somebody else, or, you know, Obama. Well, Obama, I guess, being a president, he kind of works with that firsthand. But anyway, not celebrities, not people, you know, who do advertisement or campaigns for candidates, but actual scientists and practitioners who work in this area. So I will present to you what they have to say about the topic, and I just hope you will give them a chance through me to explain their opinion to you, and hopefully you will be wise enough to at least listen to that and then maybe formulate your opinion. And who knows, maybe on some topics your opinion will coincide with that of the experts. But again, my experience shows that more often than not, many people have a very strong opinion purely based on emotions and very limited personal experience. But enough of that. Let's talk some more about me and about you and about the course. My name is Vas Terrace. I do have a PhD, and many people call me doctor. But if you want to impress me and show me your respect, just do your homework on time. And, you know, don't give me too much trouble. Just follow the syllabus, and I'll be very happy with that. And call me by my first name otherwise, all right? I got a PhD in international management from the University of Calgary. Before that, I got a master's in economics from the University of Texas at Dallas, and my bachelor's was also in economics. I specialize now primarily in international team management, training development for international teams, evaluation of effectiveness of training for international teams, and HR policies in general. I also do some research on immigration, economic effects of immigration, and things in that area. I have lived, worked, and studied in and taught in many countries, on many continents, and I work with people from, at this time, about 80 countries on a basically daily basis. So we exchange emails, not with every single one of them every single day, but at least, you know, once per week with all of those people, mainly research and teaching. So I have some decent international experience in many things I will be talking about. I know from, you know, doing it firsthand, living it basically. But then again, I can't pretend to know all the answers, and when possible or when appropriate, I will try to present both points of view and tell you what these guys think about it, what those guys think about it. These are the arguments of each camp, and these are the statistics that we have, and you make the final decision. I'm originally from Ukraine, and those of you who don't know where Ukraine is, it's in Europe. In terms of the area, it's actually the largest European country. In terms of the population, I believe it's the third after Russia, Germany, and the United Kingdom. My hometown was right here in the west, close to the Polish border. I moved from Ukraine, or left Ukraine, when I was 16 for the first time. I've been back there a few times since then, but more than half of my life I've actually lived overseas, lately in the United States, before that in Canada, before that again in the United States, before that in Germany, a number of other European countries. Plus, as I said, I've worked and studied in quite a few additional countries. And yes, I believe this map shows briefly where I've been on a more or less permanent basis, at least for an extended period of time. So quite a few places, not Africa, not Australia so far, but you know, most of the other places. Let me just go through this. This is my lovely family, my wife and my students. My wife is a student, I mean my wife and my kids. My wife is a student at the UNCG, she is a grad student at the School of Psychology. Disclaimer, I had married her a long time ago before she went back to school, so I didn't take advantage of a student. So just for the record, because sooner or later many of you will find out that I'm married to a UNCG student, so you know, we don't have any wrong thoughts. Now a little bit about this course. Some courses are designed almost like a maze, and to find your way to an A+ requires a great deal of navigation and, you know, guessing. This course is nothing like that. I designed it to be as straight as possible in terms of your way to A+. There are no shortcuts, there are no bumps along this road. All you have to do to get your A+ is just, you know, walk the walk. The other disadvantage of the path to your A+ being so straight is because you can't take the shortcuts. Everything is very simple, and all you have to do is just do your work. But the problem is that you really have to do that work. No matter how smart you are, no matter how creative you are, it probably will not help you. And I hate to say that, but this is the reality. You will have to go through all that stuff, and there will be no way to, you know, use your previous knowledge to guess some of the answers to these questions. You can't really do much about it, so you'll have to walk the walk as everybody else. But if you do, it's very simple. You just listen to the lectures every week, you take your tests. If you do that, there is no way you can get less than A for this course. In fact, a huge portion of my students get A+, and you should be one of them. Many fail, but again, a huge portion get A+, probably more than in any other course. So if you need to boost your GPA, this is your chance. Now, here is another activity I do with my students with a real glass, but you know, for the sake of argument, let me show you also on the screen how it works. Is this glass full? I guess for you it would be there, right? Most students see that it's an empty glass, and I always have some smarty pants who say, oh no, it's not empty because there is air in it. Well, let's assume it is empty. Now if I put those rocks there, and I don't have the real rocks, but you know, imagine that I do, would that make the glass full? Well, if you said that it is full, let me redefine the question. If I added some little stones to that glass, would that be full now? What if I added some beer to it? Would it be full now? Well, that's the point. So this activity, or these things, represent very well international business knowledge. So the glass, the empty glass, represents your head. And I'm not implying that your heads are empty. In fact, you may have lots of knowledge there, which may be a problem in this course, because, you know, if you have some preconceived notions there, then I will not be able to replace them with hopefully more accurate information. But anyway, the big rocks represent basic knowledge of international business. You know, things like what is an exchange rate, where is Europe, what is job outsourcing. Those are very important issues, but if you know answers to all those questions on these basic questions, you will get an F for this course. There will be no single question on the exam that is common sense. There will be no single question on the exam that is common knowledge. Every single question will be based on the materials, on the course-specific materials. And those are these, you know, little bubbles or pebbles, right? Little rocks. So those are specialized knowledge that you will receive in this course. And this is what you need to know for the exam. So, for example, I will not be asking you to define immigration. I will be asking you about specific economic effects of immigration, and you will need to know about 10 or 15 possible outcomes of immigration if a country welcomes immigrants. The same thing, for example, regional integration. I will not ask you what is NAFTA or what countries the United States is a member or is regionally integrated with. I will ask you about specific economic outcomes of, for example, NAFTA, and you will need to give me the effects of NAFTA on wages, unemployment, prices, all those kinds of things. So it will be fairly specialized. Not difficult. Once you read the slides or a textbook, you will know the answers. But you will have to read it, and most likely you will not be able to guess those questions or answers unless you have read the materials. And yes, the BR, that's for graduate school. You know, there is so much little detail on each of those issues.
Now the most important stuff, the syllabus. You can read the syllabus obviously on your own, but let me point out a few important things. First, your student ID. When you submit your assignments, please make sure to put the last four digits of your student ID, not the entire number. The reason for that is I don't have the entire student ID number in my system. It gives me only your name and the last four digits. So if you put the whole thing, then basically the system will not automatically recognize you, and it takes me a long time to correct that error. Second, I have 200 students this semester, and each of you will probably send at least, I don't know, 10 emails to me throughout the course, which means I will have about 2,000 emails in my mailbox. It's very important that you put Management 301 somewhere in the subject line so that when the semester is over, I could search and delete those messages. The textbook, we use Wild, Wild, and Hen, and the recommended version is, or edition is, 7th. However, this particular textbook, the differences from edition to edition are not really that big. So if you want to save money, you can just go and buy an older edition. The 4th is fine, 5th is better, 6th is very good, 7th the best. The 3rd one, no, that one is very, very different. Also, if you would like to save money, here is a link here on the website, in the syllabus. If you click on this link, it will take you to a website that I put together where my former students can sell their textbooks to my current students. And so you can get some good deals. I see there are about 25 books listed at this time there. And by the way, when the semester is over, you can also sell your textbook to my future students. Blackboard course objectives, you know what those are, course overview, course format. It's an online course, as you understand, right? I also teach it in the face-to-face version, and there is lectures. In the online version, obviously, you can't attend the real lectures, but I'm trying to make it as realistic as possible for you. And for that, I create video lectures and audio lectures. So to make the online course as realistic as possible for you, I've created video lectures as well as audio lectures of the actual material. So for each chapter, you have the textbook, obviously. You have my Wordy slides, which are basically class notes, but in addition, you can actually get a video lecture, and there are two formats for those. One is what I call a talking head. That's basically what you are dealing with now. So the slide and my picture somewhere in the corner of the screen. Additionally, I also have recorded and will be recording this semester as the semester progresses, the real in-class lectures. So what you have now online is from the last semester. But also, since things change, I will be uploading the new versions of the in-class video lectures as we progress. I'm not sure which one is better, you choose. So I guess the in-class ones give you the most realistic feel of the classroom. The talking head ones are probably a little bit more efficient, so see what works best for you. In addition, I've also created audio versions of the lectures. And the reason for that is I don't want you to spend time on watching my videos because, you know, basically, well, I do want you to spend time watching my videos, but if you don't have that time, you can actually listen to my lectures. And so this way, if you just put them on your cell phones, you can just listen to them when you drive to work or work in a garden or work out in a gym, whatever works for you. And then obviously there will be a number of assignments that you will submit to me, and we will also communicate via email. Now, should you watch the video lectures? I would say yes, you should. There are several reasons for that. One, The textbook does a good job, but not a perfect job. And so there will be some things on the exam that are not covered in the textbook, things from my own experience, things that I feel are important, but the authors of the textbook didn't cover that, as well as there are some things in the textbook that are not very relevant, a little, you know, questionable stuff. And so that is not covered in the video lectures. So the video lectures are tailored towards to exams. So if you watch the video lectures, you will have the most efficient, most focused content of the lectures, I mean of the course. Additionally, if you watch the video lectures, I've embedded 5 questions in each one of them, 5 questions that are very similar to the ones that you will see on the exam. Same format, same difficulty. In fact, of those 5, I guarantee that at least one will actually be on the exam. So this gives you a good preview of what to expect on the exam, kind of makes you review the material as you listen to the lecture, and basically prepares you for the exam. Those questions are not included in the slides that are posted online. So those are basically bonuses for the ones who watch the lectures. So I highly recommend those. But again, if you prefer to work with the text, that's perfectly fine. You have the textbook and you have the class notes in the forms of the slides. Talking about the slides, again, I deliberately designed them to be wordy. You actually see sometimes full sentences. And I know that a presentation shouldn't have that much text on the slides, but this is not really a presentation. If I were trying to sell you something, yes, I would use the style that Steve Jobs uses, picture, maybe one word. Here, the goal of the slides is to deliver class notes effectively, so that when you are preparing for the exam, even if you missed the lecture or if you did take it but a long time ago and you don't remember all the details, by looking at the wordy slides, you can actually get a good comprehensive review of the material, not just the keywords. Letter grade, nothing unusual here. The grading. There will be 3 exams, non-cumulative. There will be 3 take-home assignments, and there will be the Exculture project. Let me talk about each of them separately. Oh, and plus, on top of that, you have ample opportunities to earn extra bonuses, so that the total that you can actually earn, in theory at least, is 105 points, not 100. So if you do all those bonuses, you can actually earn a little bit extra points. Now let me talk about all those separately. Now the course grade composition. There will be 3 exams, non-cumulative. There will be 3 take-home assignments, and there will be the Exculture project. I will talk about each of them separately now, but also I would like to point out that in this course you have ample opportunities to earn some bonuses. For example, when you work in a team on the take-home assignments, you get a little bonus. Or if you see anything in this course that you feel may be improved, again, send me an email, give me that input for course improvement, and I'll give you extra bonuses. But I'll talk about each of those separately, so let's move on. First, the exams. Nothing really unusual. You will have 3 exams, non-cumulative, taken online, 40 questions each, all multiple choice questions. The only thing that you have to keep in mind is that for the exams, I will give you 48-hour windows when you can take them, and then once you start the exam, you will have 75 minutes to finish it, right? So you can start anytime within those 48 hours, but once you start, you cannot stop. You have to finish the exam. The timing per question would be roughly 2 minutes. It's actually 1.9 minutes, which is a little bit more actually than for the students who take the course in class. They have only 1.75 minutes, but roughly more or less the same. Obviously, for you taking the course online, the exams will be basically open books, open notes. I guess, unfortunately, for those who take the course in face-to-face settings, and luckily for you, it is open books, open notes. The students who take the course in face-to-face settings, they have exam jeopardy, which gives them extra opportunities to earn bonuses. So in the end, I expect your grades to be similar with their grades. But then again, you have this huge advantage, and I don't like the fact that your exams are open books, open notes. But at the same time, I realize there is no way I can police that, I can prevent that. So yes, obviously you can use books, notes, and whatever else you can use. Take-home assignments, nothing unusual again. There will be 3 of them. You will have to complete all 3, but the lowest grade will be dropped. If you miss one of the assignments, you will get 0 for that one, but again, that 0 will be dropped. So effectively, you can do only 2 if you want to. Or, for example, you do the first 2, you get 100s on both of them. And then, yes, obviously there is no point in doing the third one. I still encourage you to do it, but you don't have to. Second, you can do the take-home assignments individually or in teams. If you do it in teams, you will first have to decide on your own team. So basically you find the team members. And I have a link right here where you can list your interest in working in a team or find and see who is interested in working in a team and contact those people. So because coordination in a team is more complex, as I said, I'm going to give you an extra 1 point for working in a team. If you would like to work in a team, the team cannot be more than 3 people. And more importantly, you must send me an email with the names of your teammates at least 48 hours in advance. The reason for that is I don't want you selling spots on your team, places on your team right before the deadline. So I encourage you to work in teams. Teams work better than individuals. They tend to get higher grades. And yes, by all means, please do work in a team. I'll give you a bonus if you do. But if you decide to work in a team, do inform me in advance about your team composition. No last minute deals there. You work together, you inform me in advance, and then it's fine. Now, in terms of the format of the take-home assignment and the submission mode, about 10 days before the deadline, right before we cover, or right after we cover the material on the topic, each one of you will receive an email with the link to the take-home assignment. And so when you click on that link, it will take you to an online form, like an online open question quiz, if you will. And your job is to basically type in the answers. The link will take you to that form, and the form automatically saves your answers as you move on. So if you want to take a pause and return to it a day later, that's fine. It will remember your answers. I still recommend that you do copy and paste those answers in a Word file, just in case something goes wrong, you have the record. But other than that, yes, it should be as easy as basically working with a Microsoft Word file, with the only difference that you will access it through a personalized link that I will email to each one of you. If you work in a team, you have to submit only one submission per team. So let's say there are 3 people on the team. So one of you, just select who that is, clicks on his or her link. The first question will be, are you working in the team? And if so, give me the names of the rest of the team. The person provides the names of the rest of the teams, and you submit your work only once. Very easy. It may sound a little confusing now, but you'll see there is really nothing unusual about that. X-Culture Project, that's the most exciting part. A long time ago, when I was teaching this course for the first time, I thought it would be nice if you, my students, had some practical international business experience. And I thought it would be nice if maybe I could find another professor in another country who teaches a similar course to the one I teach, and so his students or her students could work with my students, and thereby the students would gain some practical experience in global collaboration. I didn't know how to find that professor, so I sent out an email through the Academy of International Business asking if anyone would like to participate. And to my amazement, there were many, many people who did. And so now, a few years later, we have about 3,000 students from about 80 universities in 40-something countries on all 6 continents and major island groups participating in the project. So you will have a chance to participate in it this semester. The way it works is we take the students, we put them in teams, usually of 6, each being from a different country. So basically you have 6 or 7 students from 6 or 7 different countries, and you will have a business proposal to write, and you have a whole semester to do that. Actually a little bit less than a whole semester, but you have a lot of time to do that. Now, the good thing is that we have real live companies working with us and providing us with real life challenges. And so if you happen to impress one of those companies, there is actually a good chance you may end up with a job offer. Now, at the end of the project, you will get certificates, and so those basically certify your experience in global collaboration. Again, a good thing to show around Christmas dinner to your parents, you know, brag about your international experience. But also we have had a number of cases when those help students get jobs. In fact, here I have links to a couple of articles about our UNCG students whose story was, you know, in a simplified version, I was at a job interview, it was not going anywhere, and then I mentioned about my X-Culture experience, and they said, oh, tell me more. I told them, and they said, sure, you are hired, and we want to send you, for example, in the case of one of my students described here in this newspaper article, he was sent to Brussels to work for VF. And if you don't know what VF is, it's the largest clothing company in the world, headquartered, by the way, in Greensboro. Those guys own just about every clothing brand from, you know, North Face, Columbia, Lee, Wrangler, Keen, just about everything except for maybe Nike and Levi's. So twice a year on top of that, we invite the best students to a what we call X-Culture Symposium. Students meet face to face. The meeting is normally hosted at a company. And so, for example, we had the last meeting hosted by Mercedes-Benz at their bus and truck factory, met with the management, did the presentations, got the prizes. The next one will be in late October of this year, and this one will be hosted by the Home Depot in Atlanta at their headquarters. Again, Home Depot strongly suggested that they will probably have some job openings right there at the meeting, so there is a good chance some of the students will get either job offers or internship offers. Now, talking about the X-Culture project, you don't have to participate in it if you don't want to. Working with people across time zones, languages, geography, culture may be overwhelming and may be time consuming. If you're not sure if you have the time and the commitment to do it, it's okay, you can opt out. You can complete the same project on your own, and in that case I will just grade it as a term paper. You will have to do all the work by yourself, but then you will not have to deal with all those differences and distances. So in a sense, you'll probably end up spending more or less the same time, but you will miss out on the international component of it. And obviously you will not get the international collaboration certificate. But again, for some students it may be the preferred option, and if that's your preference, perfectly fine, I understand. In terms of grading, so if you do it individually, yes, obviously you just submit it as a paper and then grade it as a paper. If you do it in a team, then to me the paper is important, but even more important to me is your international experience. So I will be more interested in your ability to work with the team than the actual content of the paper. So there will be a series of pass-fails in a sense. So you will have to first survey will be, have you been able to establish contact with your team members? As long as you have completed the report, even if some team members didn't respond to you, you get your first pass or first 100. Next deadline, your team has to decide on the company for which you will be writing the business proposal. Again, as long as you decided by the deadline, that's next pass, that's another 100. Next deadline, decide on the product and the country where you will be selling it. Again, you do it by the deadline, you make that decision as a team, I'm happy, I give you another 100. Peer evaluation is the same thing, so as long as you get more than 75 from your peers, I'm happy, you generally they generally liked you, you get 100. Same thing with the report. Executive summary looks good, 100. Next one, introduction looks good, 100, and so on and so on. If something doesn't look good, or if you miss a deadline, it's a zero. Normally, most students get 100s on all deadlines, but I occasionally have some students who just miss a deadline or forget to file a report or something else is done wrong, then they get some zeros and the overall average may be lower. But again, you should be able to easily get 100 on this assignment as long as you make a considerable investment of time. So it's not going to be easy, it will take a lot of effort, but if you do it, you're pretty much guaranteed 100. So if you need to improve your GPA, that's your chance. Now, at the end of the syllabus here, you see that we have the list of topics that will be covered in the test, I mean in the course. And for each of those topics, you have a set of green questions. Those are optional questions. That's basically you showing me that you care about the material and you give it some thought. So there are assignments posted on Blackboard in course documents. If you would like to earn some bonuses, you answer those questions to the best of your abilities, free format, no special requirements. Just type up your answers in a Word file, and then just basically submit them over Blackboard, and if you do, I will give you a 0.1 bonus for each of those lectures. So we have a total of 23 lectures, so you can get up to 2.3 points for your answers to the green bonus questions. Again, many students don't do it, but some do it. You know, your way, your opportunity to get some bonuses. I already talked about course improvement bonuses, so again, if you see any problems, like for example typos in the slides or in the syllabus, or if you run across a video or newspaper article that are relevant to the content of this course, or if you have ideas for better assignments or better exam questions, send me your suggestions and I will happily give you bonus points. Again, it's point one for each correction, and believe me, there are many typos in this syllabus, in the slides. English is not my first language, it's not even my second language, it's not even my third language, it's my fourth language. So obviously, you know, there are many opportunities to correct me, and if you do, I will gladly give you points and will appreciate your input. Other than that, there is really nothing that I need to mention about the course. As I said, you see all the topics here. I should say probably a couple words on the difference between my online versus face-to-face course. So you are taking it online or face-to-face, and the two are basically identical. The only difference is that obviously those who take the course online, they don't have an opportunity to participate in real time, but you can still answer those green bonus questions and thereby show me that you do something extra. Those who take it in class have lectures, that's understood. Obviously, those who take it in class and take lectures, they have a participation credit or participation component of the grade, whereas those who take the course online, there is no participation. The exams are a little different, so those who take the course in class, they have in-class exam with the booklets, and for those who want to really know, they will have the exams in the individual and team component. So they'll write the test basically twice, and their individual answers will count for 90%, their team answers will count for 10%. Those of you who take the course online, that is not an option, so you just take the class online, I mean the exam online, and answer the questions, and you know, it would be very difficult to arrange for those teams. And finally, those who take the course in class use iClickers, so there is a bunch of questions that I mentioned that they will see each lecture, and as long as they answer them with the iClickers, they get extra participation points. Whereas for those who take the course online, there is no participation component, so you don't have the iClickers, and I guess the only way I know if you do your stuff or not is by your answers to the exam questions, your assignments, and your Xculture project. Other than that, it's basically the same, and I hope you will enjoy the course, and if you have any questions, just send me an email.